Volume 1 of the Vietnam Archives home movie series is the personal 8mm footage of Major Alfred DeMilo of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and Captain James Powell of Nashville, Tennessee. Major DeMilo is active in the Pennsylvania National Guard, and Captain Powell is retired from the U.S. Army after having served 22 years of active duty. The Vietnam Archives presents this amateur film footage by permission of the authors. The narration which accompanies this footage is candid and unrehearsed. No script was written. This narration, as all narration acquired by the archives, was recorded in the contributor's own home.
This is in April or May of 68, showing a flight of 10 lift birds, UH-1s, coming in, doing a troop exchange, bringing in troops from the field. It's been out there for 4 or 5 months, and they're replacing them with fresh troops, making a drop-off here, the exchange. Flight of 10, 128th Assault Helicopter Company out of Fuloy. Tired or older troops getting out on the right, new troops hopping in on the left. We're just sitting here, we're flying a gunship in just a relatively safe area, just waiting for the next liftoff. This is an artillery strike going in the Delta. I think we're working with the 9th Infantry then, south of Saigon. See the artillery as it hits the real marshy area and monsoon area. Flying with Jack Schweizer, pilot, flying a gunship. Right after the artillery strike, we're going in to soften the area again before the troops come in, shooting rockets, 2.75-inch rockets, door gun or mini guns, You'll see that in a few minutes. But you see all the water. It's really marshy, and you might think, well, it's kind of hard for anybody to be down there. But surprisingly, the Viet Cong can really hide in that nip of palm and in the dike lines and tunnels. It's amazing where they can be. This is the one of the crew chief getting ready to mark the LZ with yellow smoke. We're coming in real for a low pass, marking the landing zone for the lead aircraft. There is a door gun, which is a minigun. Tremendous weapon. You can see the barrel's spin, puts out 4,000 rounds per minute. Good crew chief could write his name in the water with that thing. It's amazing. You can see the spray. Again, prepping the LZ. There was and there's our wingman going for, he just finished a pass, and we're coming in now. You can see the door gun, bullets, rocket fire, right at the edge of the landing zone. Quite a bit of mud there, too. We had to watch out, do a fairly sharp turn, keep from hitting the mud from the blast, because it can knock out your windshield, knock out your chin bubble. One rocket went high there. But that was quite a bit of nip bomb, quite an area for hiding. Now we're working with the infantry company down in the Delta with the 9th Infantry, and they set up a temporary support base for us. I had four gunships, 128th Assault Helicopter Gunslingers was our code name. Came in to rearm and refuel. Some of the guys there, we just finished a mission, come back in to reload. Took about 30 minutes to reload. Machine gun fire. There's the crew chiefs. There's some of the pilots talking. Pete Jansen laughing at his back to us. Larry Wagner talking. Both those guys had been shot in the legs. Larry had been shot through both legs with one bullet a few months earlier. Went into the hospital, came back, came to us. He was with a different unit that time. Pete got shot in the leg once before this filming and once after. This is the biggest helicopter in the Army inventory at that time, the CH-54. Quite an aircraft. It could really carry a heavy load. In fact, it would carry about the size of a railroad car, right between the wheels. You see those sticking down? It just sat right on top of it, clamp onto it, and take it off. It wasn't a railroad car, but it was like a railroad car. Tremendous lift on that thing. Back at Phu Loi, and here's my door gunner, Paul Bonnet, carrying rockets as we were coming in to reload. Jim Cozine, my other guy I was flying with, another pilot. Paul Bonnet was killed later in a crash. We were shot down a few weeks later. There's Paul in the white t-shirt. I went to see his mother in Springfield, Mass, and talking to her one day, and I hadn't mentioned how he was killed. He was pinned under the aircraft, and it was on fire, and we hit the ground pretty hard and flipped over. And there's Paul loading the ammunition now. But she'd mentioned that she was in a gas station about 9:30 one night and heard a loud scream and just couldn't figure out where it came from. Well, I hadn't mentioned to her, but Paul, when I was trying to get him out of the aircraft, he let out a loud scream just before he died. It was about 9:30 in the morning. So it was about 12 hours, and it was on the same day that the crash happened. Here we're putting in an infantry company in a real kind of a marshy, tall grass, kind of a really uncomfortable area. Putting in a new infantry battalion in an area, or rather an infantry battalion into a new area that they're going to set up a fire support base. You can see the troops jump out on each side, rush out to the side, get out away from the aircraft so we can get off as quick as we could. Dodge the trees, get formed up again, and head back to the base to get more troops. Here we're doing a little bit of formation flying. Did quite a bit of formation flying, actually, at 1,500 feet, trying to stay out of the small arms range. Going back into, and where we were picking up the troops from, was Lai K, which was about 25 to 30 miles north of Saigon, 1st Infantry Division, 1968, latter part, about July 1968. Another battalion coming out to get lined up. We're getting ready to load them up on the aircraft, and we were there just a little bit early. They weren't quite ready for us. They're getting out to line up, get ready for us to take them out to that same area we were just in a few minutes ago, another battalion. So we're taking a break. Flew all day. Many times get up early in the morning, take off, not get back to the base till late at night. There's Ray Broom, good friend of mine. But now we're cranking the aircraft up, getting ready to take this next load out. You can see these guys, I really felt sorry for them going out. They're carrying everything they own, 4 and 5 canteens there, machine guns. Going out for about 3 to 6 months, operate out of that new base area. Here's a mortar platoon. You can see the guys carrying some really pretty heavy equipment, some ammunition. Duffel bag full of all his equipment and gear. Back out, formation flying again. It took us about 25 to 30 minutes to get out to that other area. It was about 60 miles away. And here the Army Cav unit had come into the area and put a perimeter of defense out around the area for us. And we're coming back in with a new load, dodging trees, trying to find good places to land. It was really difficult. High grass. Big mounds. By the way, those mounds of dirt were from anthills. Big anthills. Troops jump out, get in the grass. We take off. Trying to keep an eye on each other and try to stay in line, in formation. Miss the trees at the same time. It's kind of tricky. Smoke there marked a landing site for the lead aircraft to come to the smoke so that we knew where they wanted the next load of troops in. Try not to stay on the ground very long. Try to get the troops in, get off the ground quickly. Many times you could take a lot of sniper fire, and if you kept flying over the same area all the time, you could easily draw fires there. I guarantee there was Viet Cong watching us put the troops in. This is my rocket sight, just putting it down to show Mom and Dad. This is the inside, the instrument panel of the aircraft. I'll show a little bit of what the instruments look like, engine and transmission instruments, showing airspeed there. We were flying about 90 knots, straight and level. We were about 1,000 feet above the ground at that point, doing a little bit of a descent, about 400 foot per minute. It was 8:30 in the morning. There's navigational instruments. Here we're down south of Saigon. I was working with the SEALs, Navy SEALs, and they were responsible for protecting the Saigon River, the shipping, the cargo ships going in and out of Saigon. You can see some bunkers down there that Viet Cong built right there with some graves. Viet Cong people had died, and there's a grave field there for the Viet Cong. Really muddy. Foliage had been defoliated with some agent. Here's some bunkers there. You can see the entrance right there, a little square entranceway. And those things were really hard to destroy because they were full of logs and mud on top. This is back at Phu Loi, our home base. And this shows a little tower that we had built for our platoon members. And I was the platoon leader of the gunship platoon, and we called ourselves the Gunslingers as a nickname. And this shows our living area. 2 and 3 men to a room. And this shows the area on the inside of our living quarters, and bunkers right outside our doors, because many times at night we had to run out and hop in those bunkers when we were taking rocket fire from the Viet Cong out around our perimeter. Some of my fellow gunslingers, Don Juan, Jack Swizer, Joe Hatley, Mark Westfall, Sal Siaka. But we'd stand on our tower for a little bit of recreation every now and then, look over the area and kind of dominate. There you can see the machine gun fire from the door gunner on the right-hand side. Every bullet you see there is actually 1 in 5. So there's 4 bullets between every red one, a little phosphorus on the leading edge of the bullet so that it will light up so you can see where you're shooting. And here we're prepping an LZ, getting ready to insert some troops again. And we'd always go in early before the left platoon came in, before the left or the infantry troops, try to soften the area and shoot suspected areas where there might be hiding. Let the Viet Cong know we were coming in. Keep their heads down where we brought the troops in. There's the rocket fire. We're going to be putting the troops right in the grassy area, right at the lead smoke there. A couple of rockets going in. A little river right on the top side of the landing zone. This was, again, an area quite a ways away from any fire support area, or rather from any towns and facilities. It's kind of out in the woods, lots of bamboo, there's lots of jungle. Not a very comfortable area to be flying over. They were putting the troops in. You just barely see the lift birds going down now, just touching down. And I'm making a pass going back to line up again. My wingman is already beside the lift birds as they're going in. And here we're activating an abandoned airstrip. And this is between 2 and 3 Corps. This is about 80 to 100 miles northeast of Saigon. You can see the landing strip there. It's really kind of overgrown. They decided to reactivate this area, so we came back in. And the NVA had moved into this area and built some facilities. And here we're going to come in and do a little shooting. And we found a few areas, and we're going to put some machine gun fire into them and try to get somebody to shoot at us so we can find out where they are. There's been a lot of artillery strikes going in. You can just barely see a facility right there, a hut that the NVA had built. It was really difficult to see. It was kind of steep in ravines, and it was real tough flying in this area. And getting ready to prep it. Well, we'd been doing quite a bit of it. Lots of shooting, pretty dry, lots of things caught on fire, trees. So we're back at Lycay here with the 1st Infantry, and we're doing rearm and refuel and just taking a few minutes break. Many times we'd have breaks between missions from one unit to another, so we had a chance to get out of the helicopter, but quite often we never had a chance to get out, and you'd fly 12 hours sitting in that seat. All you could do was stop, rearm, refuel. Sullivan, John Sullivan, it's my crew chief. I'm sorry, but I forget his name. Watson, Ray Broom, some of the pilots standing around joking, relaxing, taking a smoke break. There's my other, I had 4 gunships that day. There's a Cobra taking off from Lycay. Not too many of them in country at that time, and in 68, early 69. So I'm gonna let somebody take a picture of me for Mom and Dad. Okay, start it. Early morning. Used to fall asleep sometimes flying. Really did quite a bit, lots of fatigue. Real tired there. We're going in to, again, prep an LZ. When I say prep, put a lot of rocket fire, machine gun fire down to clear an area, soften it up, get the Viet Cong away from the landing zone, get them in the ground and hide an undercover so that we can get the troops in right away, and they can get a full foothold in without getting shot at or receiving too much fire. Now here it was really dry. This was a dry season. Everything caught fire. Grass, trees. It's kind of hard not to start fires. There's the lift birds going in. One blade was painted white so you could see them below you. Otherwise, sometimes it's pretty hard to see. A lot of mid-air collisions, unfortunately. Lots of dust here. The troops, when they got on the ground, they kind of had to crawl away from the fire. Right south of Saigon here, and this is a kind of a marshy area. Infantry unit had called us in to give them some gun cover, gunship cover, and they were in contact with some Viet Cong. As soon as we got there, we found 2 guys just jumping out of the weeds, and my door gunner, first round, got this one, and his partner we shot a little bit later. Back in, rearm, refuel. It's a lot of work. Do this all day long. Sweat, grit, hot, tired. Lots of work. Twin 60s, M60 machine guns. We put 2 of them together for the door gunner. But what he's loading up right now is for the gun system that the pilot would fire. Carry about 12,000 rounds total, machine guns and rockets. Little piece of wood here on the side. Knock yourself out. Knock on wood for luck. So I'm just hamming it up a little bit. Back out, prepping his LZ, and this one was a hot one. We'd taken some fire back in to shoot back. Trying to get a few rounds in between the trees. We carried different systems on the aircraft. One aircraft might have 14 rockets, another one would have 48. Lots of machine gun fire. Sometimes we had two of our birds had grenade launchers in the nose. This area was a bad area. We had been in heavy contact. Infantry had been in heavy contact. We came in and fought back. We moved off to the side when it got heavy, brought in artillery and airstrikes. You just saw a jet come in and do a little bombing strike. When he was done, we'd move back in. This is a command and control bird. During this same day, during this heavy action, this was a really busy day, unfortunate day for quite a few people. But here, our command and control bird had a hydraulics failure. Infantry commander, our company commander, was on board. I followed him into our landing, the nearest landing strip. He'd lost his hydraulics, and when you lose hydraulics control in your helicopter, it's very hard to move the controls and to fly it. Doing some orbits around a church here, it was really interesting. This thing was really unique. The entrance here had some figures right above the entranceway that was just kind of different. But we, as we had a chance then, we moved back out to the area of heavy contact. You can see all the smoke from artillery rounds going in. We put an infantry company in out here, and they got pretty well destroyed. Coming back in, machine gun, they're shooting, the Viet Cong are shooting at this time. I'm coming in, trying to get them to jump back in their tunnels. And you can see right off on the right side where that pair of rockets went was a machine gun nest. Infantry company right there on the ground, 60 man company in, 35 of them. As soon as we left, were killed by four machine gun nests. Viet Cong ran a charge. You can see three Viet Cong on top of the company commander, sergeant, first sergeant, several other troops. So 60 men in, 35 were killed right away. The others kept inching their way back as we were making passes, trying to get back to safety. I had my door gunner take these pictures, by the way. I didn't even see them the first time in. But we were trying to suppress their fire. Every time we'd come in making a pass, the injured and the live ones would move back and kept crawling back. 10 were not wounded, 15 were injured, 35 were killed. We were taking in here for a refuel and rearm stop. Air Force was back into the area doing some more bombing strikes. We were trying to take lunch, but we really didn't feel like eating. It was Larry Wagner, a friend of mine, just throwing his lunch away. Just really not a good feeling to lose so many so quickly. Watching artillery strike going in from the base we were at, they were pounding the hillsides around. See the smoke coming up. Now we back out to the area. Now we're extracting dead. We're back out to cover people on the ground to do the picking up of the bodies and recovering people. There you can see one of the machine gun nests, a few things they dug out from there, one that we had hit earlier. We're at the edge of the tree line. I'd talked to the company commander while we were out there before, just before it happened, because we put them in, covered them going into it. We had taken sniper fire from the trees areas in the back, and I told them to be careful. It looked kind of nasty there. And we hadn't been gone too long, and as soon as we left, the Viet Cong jumped up out of their tunnels and really cut them down. Back at Fuloy, our home base, you can see the revetment areas where we parked the aircraft and a hangar in the background. Usually weren't back there for very long. Get ready to go out again. Everybody's cranking their engines. Usually went out with a flight of 10. There's a lift bird, or slick, we called them. They had door guns, and the reason we called them slicks was because we carried guns, machine guns, and rockets, whereas the lift birds just had the door gunners and the door guns for suppressive fire, mainly to carry troops, whereas we were to carry the machine guns and rockets, grenade launchers, to provide cover and gunship support to protect those lift birds. You see the flight of 10 cranking up. And there's some that are winding down. Others are taking off. Some are just come in to shut down, take a break. There's a revetment areas where provided protection for the aircraft. Whenever rocket fire came in at night and exploded, it gave some protection. Here we're over near Cu Chi in monsoon season, working with the CAV unit. They had just told me on the radio to get out from behind them because they're going to start shooting into this lots of nipa-palm and treed area. It was a Viet Cong headquarters had been located there, and they were going in to destroy it. Troops are on the ground, kind of hard to see, clumps of 4 and 5 waiting for pickup, and we're covering them. We're there early before the troop birds get there, lift birds, and we're just providing a little gun cover, a little protection. Back in again, rearm, refuel. We used to fly 10 to 12 hours a day. There's a crew chief, good man. This was the second time back to Vietnam, and he'd come right back to the same company he was in before. His old Watson, good friend. But the crew chief I was just talking about, and I don't remember his name, had been in this same company a year before and was involved in a crash. Actually, they had got shot down, and he jumped out, ran up to the front part, pulled out one of the pilots to help him get out who was injured. They were taking fire from a tree line, and a bullet came in and through the trees hit the pilot he was holding in his arms, carrying him out, hit him in the chest, and the man died in his arms. But he came back to Vietnam, and he was a good crew chief, good man to have. Good to have the experience. And the ham here getting in, getting ready to crank up for our next mission. Strapping in. Flying in fatigues. There's a hole in my fatigue shirt showing up. It was an old timer there. I've been there 11 months, had one more month to go. I was just about ready to come home at this time.